And we are back on the Zero Hour. I am Richard R. J. Eskow, and joining us now is our good friend Yasha Levine, investigative journalist, reported from many continents of the globe, currently writer for Pando Daily, covering the Silicon Valley, or as he calls it, the Surveillance Valley. Yasha, thanks for joining us.
I'm glad to be back. Thanks for having me.
Oh, always a pleasure. Now, speaking of the Surveillance Valley, one of the reasons I wanted to have you on, the main reason actually, is you got a book you're working on about, you've done a lot of coverage on how the Silicon Valley has created this extraordinary surveillance machine that knows so much about us. You've covered a lot of the interconnections between the Silicon Valley and the defense industry and so on. And now you have a book coming. Tell us about that a little bit.
Yeah. So the book is called Surveillance Valley, The Rise of the Google Military Complex. And it deals with a kind of a big overarching question and issue that I think hovers in the background that I think a lot of people think about, maybe not very consciously, but we kind of know that it's there. And the issue is this. You know, the Internet... from the beginning of the Internet revolution, right, we've been told that we're witnessing this, the dawn of a new era, the dawn of a liberating new technology, a technology that was supposed to empower the grassroots, topple entrenched bureaucracies, reduce inequality, you know, herald in a new era of direct democracy where the people finally had power. But instead what we've seen is almost the exact opposite, right? What we've seen is a system that has created more inequality, has created this massive total surveillance, for-profit surveillance system. It spawned global monopolies. It minted hundreds of new billionaires, including 23 just last year in California. And it's just, the Internet empowered the U.S. national security state as well. So the question is, how did this supposedly liberating technology so quickly lead to the dystopian reality that we're living in today? And that's what I want to address in my book. That's a question that I want to answer, and I will answer it.
Now, you have a Kickstarter campaign about this book. What's that all about? Is that so you can finish it? Is that so you can publish it?
Both, yeah. So I've been working on this book, but it's still in its early stages. And the Kickstarter is to raise funds to cover the costs of writing the book, the research and the travel and things like that, and also to cover the costs of making it into a product that people can buy and read. So copy editing, proofreading, editing, stuff like that. Cover design. So yeah, so the whole deal. So yeah, covering the cost of writing the book and making the book as well.
So you're going to bypass the whole publishing system altogether. You're not going to try to get a publishing house to put this out.
Yeah, exactly. I was in talks with several publishers over the last few months, and in talking to them, I realized that the book takes on such a big subject and takes on such a powerful company. Not just a single company like Google or Amazon or maybe Facebook or Apple or just even a couple of them, but like the whole system. And for it to be really, the work is so counter-establishment and anti-establishment that it would really benefit it greatly for it to be as independent and as free of editorial control and, advertiser or publisher pressure as possible. So, yeah, so I'm completely going, skirting around the whole publishing system and putting it out independently.
Yeah, a lot of people don't realize, I think, when they see a book printed that, look, there are business people behind that. And they can be great people. They can be good people. They can be people who love literature or whatever. But they are business people, and they're not going to be crazy about publishing necessarily, about publishing something that trashes the corporations they have to do business with. We've already seen how ruthless Amazon can be.
Exactly.
So, yeah, I get you. I feel you, and I think that's a great idea. So before we move on, there were a couple quick things I wanted to talk to you about. But before we get off the subject of your new book, which I'm looking forward to reading, where can people go maybe to kick in and help you out with that?
Yeah, I mean, so there's a website that they can go to, and that'll lead them to the Kickstarter page. It's very simple. It's called, the website is surveillancevalley.net. So surveillancevalley.net, one word. And that's the webpage for the book. And they can follow a link to the Kickstarter campaign. And, you know, the Kickstarter campaign, you know, you can give as much as you're able to, but the minimum there is you can pre-order the book. And so it's just $15 for the pre-order of the book, and you'll get it before anyone else does. So I'd really appreciate it if your listeners could support it. It's an important project and it's an important topic. Yeah.
Well, I'd appreciate it too, because I'm kicking in, and if more people do, then I get to read the book. So, Yasha Levine, surveillancevalley.net, was it? Surveillancevalley.net?
Yep.
Okay.
Right. Surveillancevalley.net. Surveillance is kind of a tough word to spell sometimes, and if you write it over and over and over and over again, it gets a little confusing, yeah. But it's a big word.
And if you type it over and over again, the NSA comes for you.
Exactly. If you say it three times and you light a candle in front of a mirror. Yeah.
Candyman. Now, okay, surveillancevalley.net, folks. And before we go on to that, you've also been covering, and this is not Surveillance Valley related, but Ukraine, the situation over there. And you've been over there and reported from there as well. What do you think's going on there now? How do you decode all this stuff?
Oh man, well it's just a giant mess. I mean, it just keeps getting worse and worse. So the fighting has somewhat stopped, and so there's somewhat of a ceasefire in effect. But you know, the economic situation, and so once the war has sort of died down a little bit, you know, the economic situation of the country has just come to the fore, and it's devastating. I mean, it's in a spiraling depression. You know, I mean, you have essentially a country that is, I don't even know how it's getting by, and its future is really in question. You have potentially inflation as high as 300% right now. You have the collapse of the currency. You have banks that are going belly up. So just the other day, the fourth largest bank in the country, closed its doors and is completely insolvent. The GDP of the country is so bad that it's actually worse now than it was, in 1992, right when the country transitioned from the Soviet Union into an independent Ukraine. And so, I mean, it's like rolling back the clock, you know? And going back to the troubles of the early 90s and the shock therapy and the privatization schemes that really plunged the country into the dark times. And so it's really,
and we don't see the U.S. really, beyond military posturing and chest beating, I don't really seem to see the U.S. stepping in and saying this is what we can do to mediate and create a way out of this crisis. It seems like we're inflaming the crisis.
Yeah, no, exactly. I mean, just today, I think, or yesterday, Boehner, led a delegation to ask President Obama to provide lethal military aid to Ukraine. Yeah, I mean, there's really no talk. I mean, the IMF is providing a bailout package. I think maybe the total bailout package would be like $50 billion, but right now it's, I think, about $25 billion. It would be a loan, an IMF loan, and in order to get this loan, Ukraine has to make sweeping changes, reforms to its economy. And right now, it's just the Ukrainian Rada, which is like the parliament, voted in, pension cuts and cuts to gas subsidies and all sorts of things that, cut pensions and cut government spending and increase the cost of heating and energy to the Ukrainian citizens. I think the price of gas is now going to be twice as high as it was before this whole revolution occurred.
So it's a really tough situation. And then in the middle of it, we have the assassination of Boris Nemtsov, and who was just about to release a report suggesting that Russian troops were very involved in the fighting. Any thoughts on that or insights on that?
No, I mean, I probably know as much as you do. I mean, I read the reports coming out about that. Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if that's true. You know, there was several Russian media outlets, including a TV station, independent TV station, and independent newspaper, you know, have been publishing reports on Russia's involvement, Russian army's involvement in Ukraine, and reporting on the deaths of Russian soldiers that have been sort of covered up by the Russian media. So, you know, this isn't news. Maybe there was, it would be new revelations. I don't know if this would be tied to his murder, or not, but it's, you know, it's, again, it shows, I don't think, Russia's involvement in Ukraine, military involvement in Ukraine would come to us as a surprise to many Russians, nor would I think they be, would they necessarily be against that.
Also, not a surprise to many Ukrainians either. So,
yeah.
All right. So thanks a lot for coming on the show. The and by the way, it's Boehner. I keep telling you that. No, Yasha Levine.
No, I know.
Yeah, no, I know you know. I'm kidding. Yeah. All right. Yasha Levine, investigative journalist, author of the forthcoming book Surveillance Valley, which you can help crowdfund on at surveillancevalley.net. Yasha, as always, thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for having me.
You bet. I'm Richard R.J. Escow, and this is The Zero Hour. We'll be right back.